Hidden away from the public eye, traveling circuses keep a dark secret.
Some of these circuses were getting jumpy, so we sent field officers out to stay on them all the time.
Now, for the first time ever, a group of animal crusaders sets out to liberate 25 captive lions spread out across a series of hotspots throughout the biologically diverse nation of Bolivia in South America.
We have to get there quickly, and we have to get these lions under our control.
A long and hard fight to shut down the use of abused animals in the circus industry has never been enforced anywhere in the world. To be successful, two animal welfare organizations will have to combine forces.
I'm starting to feel the nervousness of this whole thing, just to make sure that it all goes well.
Together, they must face down aggressors and build a one-of-a-kind structure with no time to lose. The potential to be met by hostile reception is real. The odds are stacked against them, and the stakes couldn't be higher. Meet the world's best team of wild animal crusaders, who are the last sign of hope to break free exotic wild animals in need. Based at the Wild Animal Sanctuary near Denver, Colorado, they are one of the few facilities in the world that actually conducts international rescues when there's nowhere else to turn. The captive wild animal crisis is one of the largest illegal trades in the world, just after weapons and drug trafficking. At the heart of this lucrative industry are traveling roadshows and circuses who make money at the expense of these creatures. The captive life of a circus animal is no laughing matter, but the real horror show goes on behind the scenes. To expose these unthinkable atrocities would take an extremely daring and major covert operation. Enter Tim Phillips and Jan Creamer, the main force behind Animal Defenders International, known as ADI. With locations in the United Kingdom and the U.S., ADI has fought for animal rights throughout the world for over 25 years. Now they put the spotlight behind the curtain to expose the abuse of circus animals. Their journey has taken them throughout Europe rescuing animals. And now the fight heads to South America. For 2 years, undercover ADI field officers working as circus workers followed the traveling shows throughout Bolivia, capturing on film everything they saw. The evidence they collected shocked the continent, and people called for an end to the suffering. 2 years of intense campaigning by ADI led to Bolivia becoming the first country in the world to ban the use of all animals in circuses with a law known as the 40-40. But getting the law passed was one thing. Recovering all of the circus animals in Bolivia is an entirely different issue. Most of the circus owners defied the new law, and now Jan, Tim, and the ADI team are back to shut them down for good. This rescue mission will target 8 remote circuses spread across Bolivia. The victims include 25 severely malnourished lions who have lived in tiny cages for their entire lives. But this mission has no guarantee of success. It will take ADI months to track down all the circuses as they travel through a large rubber tunnel. The team will also need to establish a central compound in Santa Cruz to hold the lions until they can find them a permanent home. To put the 40-40 law into effect, the ADI team needed support from the Bolivian people. In order to do this, ADI dispersed flyers throughout the country to educate the public about this haunting reality. This new law was an extremely bold move by the Bolivian government, setting the example of how other surrounding South American countries should act. The government was determined to enforce their bold law and swung into action, with ADI planning a series of raids to close down the cruel circus industry forever. This permits the ADI team to travel all across Bolivia to begin to seize lions and other animals from shocking conditions. This historic feat is now a reality, but another big challenge faces the ADI team. They must find all of the large carnivores a permanent home. Many options are on the table, but one in particular sits at the foot of the majestic Rocky Mountains. The Wild Animal Sanctuary is a unique place unlike any other in the world. Located 1 hour north of Denver, Colorado, this massive sanctuary covers 720 acres and shelters over 290 lions, tigers, bears, wolves, and a cast of other large carnivores. For more than two decades, Pat Craig has been the force behind this unique facility. His vision is the first of its kind to create large acreage habitats, allowing animals of the same species to live together as they would in the wild.
I started a long time ago, 30 years. It doesn't seem like it's been that long, but January 1980 was when I actually got my license to start taking in animals.
Pat's journey began as a headstrong 19-year-old when he was taken behind the scenes and was surprised to see surplus animals at a zoo. After taking in unwanted animals using open land on his parents' farm outside of Boulder, Colorado, it was time to look elsewhere to find a place that could be sprawling enough to help put a dent into the growing captive exotic wild animal crisis.
For me, you know, it wasn't anything that I ever planned on, and that it would be gigantic, but at the same time, I always knew from the very first time that I sent a letter to all the zoos in the United States and said, I know you have a lot of surplus and you're euthanizing them, and if you're going to euthanize something, maybe I can help. And I got over 300 responses back. That was when I realized that this was a really big problem.
The current location has been expanding ever since, providing these animals with a new lease on life for as long as they live, while educating the public about their tragic plight. Soon after, Pat became known as the go-to connection when police confiscated large, dangerous carnivores. This life of caring and rescuing exotic animals in need became a family affair, and his son Casey, who is deemed as Pat's right-hand man, will continue to keep this lifelong crusade a part of the family legacy.
Pat's a great boss as far as bosses go, but he's also my father, and so there's a lot of lines there that are allowed to be crossed between me and him that's not a normal, you know, boss and worker relationship.
Fred, you're gonna fall in the hole?
Well, back the up.
Well, you haven't thrown it that far before.
The key thing you learned real quickly was that since you didn't have the money to actually hire people to do this, you had to start learning how to do this. I think a lot of people come out and they're always amazed at the infrastructure and everything else we build. And then when we tell them that, you know, three or four people built this whole entire facility, then they're really even amazed.
Pat's core crew is made up of Casey, who became accustomed to animal behavior ever since he was born. Former volunteer turned full-time animal expert Shiloh Howlett and Becca Maselli, who Pat refers to as the daughter he never had, has some of the most varied animal caretaking experience on the sanctuary.
And I work here because I love animals. I love helping them every day. I get to do things that are different every day, and unfortunately get to help out these beautiful creatures. And this job's different every single time I come to work.
But the daily operations and hard will expected to work at the Wild Animal Sanctuary takes a toll on all who pursue this labor of love.
Today was a little over 6,300 pounds of meat.
Which is great, not so great.
But if you have the attitude that when it hits five, it's time to go home, then you're not gonna work here. And if you have to miss your sister's wedding, you have to miss your sister's wedding.
We have our family moments, both good and bad.
That was an accident, I'm sorry.
Right now, Casey and I are getting ready to go to Ohio to rescue a young black bear. That's kind of a part of it that a lot of people don't see. They see the sanctuary as a whole, but they don't really think about all the rescues that we go on, both on a large scale and a small scale. And what people don't see is that we actually do that multiple times a year.
They're always exciting and fun, so I mean, each one's a different experience.
It's 22 hours of sitting on your ass.
Yes, but I get to do it with you. How exciting.
Yeah, you're excited, I'm not.
Awesome.
Even for Pat, who started it all, he had to endure a long, hard, and dangerous learning curve to reach this point of success and respect. His love for animals brought what proved to be an arduous journey as he sustained various injuries throughout the years. But his school of hard knocks background has led him to become one of the leading experts in the care of large carnivores today.
You know, the key is not only is it hard physical work and it's hot and you get tired and it's long hours, you know, we do 12, 14 hours a day, that, you know, you get to the point where you're like, is this all worth it? And of course, when you actually get to see the animals finally out there playing, then you're like, okay, you know, you can see how happy they are. And then at that point, you're like, okay, you know, I was able to make that happen.
It's a sight to behold. As Pat roams his sanctuary grounds, all animals look up to him as the ultimate king of the pride, while curious onlookers see him as a true modern-day Dr. Doolittle. After a few days away, Casey and Shiloh return from one of their rescues and dive back into the action without a break in between.
While you guys were on that rescue, the circus guys came with these three tigers, and so they're gonna stay here for the next week and a half while they're, the main circus is down in Denver performing, and these guys can't go down there, so they needed a place to stay.
You know, we help them for two weeks, but then we just let them go. It's like, you know, you adopt a kid for 2 weeks and then just send it back.
Anyway, it's just something that we do. I've done that for 30 years, and obviously, you know, when you lock me up in a cage for the rest of my life, then you can make your choices, but that's the reason that we do it right now.
Okay, well, I'll let you out every couple of weeks.
Even with the help of other employees and passionate volunteers who help run this one-of-a-kind sanctuary, it's back to business as usual. Whether it's caring for all the animals on site or trotting the globe themselves to rescue animals in need, Pat and his team of wild animal crusaders are a force to be reckoned with to help take the fight to the captive wild animal crisis. Back in Bolivia, the planned initiative and sting operation to seize a total of 25 lions is called Operation Lion Arc.
Didn't I say this group is going to be cute?
And if successful, it will be the most epic animal rescue of its kind. With the seizure operation underway, the ADI team now needs to secure permanent homes for the lions. They had relocated lions all over the world before and were looking for the best possible habitats to ensure the lions remained in their prides with the desire to move the lions to a single location. But unless they find the right home, they may need to move the animals in small groups. This puts pressure on Jan and Tim's search for the right permanent home, and one of their last calls comes into Pat at the sanctuary.
Put the cable on them?
No, that's what I was saying. If we keep them flush with the top of the dirt, then fine, we can put the cable on later, but if we're going to put them too deep. Hello, this is Pat. Okay. So you actually have somebody that can move the cats to that facility? Okay. Okay, okay. Well, that's good to know. I'm glad you told me all that. Yeah, that's no good. I'm glad you're getting them out of there, yeah. Yeah, you need to come for a field trip. That's right. No, that'd be great. We've got a great place for them to go, so we're looking forward to it. We appreciate talking to you and getting that update. All right, take care. You bet.
Time is running out, but due to Pat's positive reputation and ADI's interest in looking for the best alternative for all of the mistreated circus animals, Jan and Tim temporarily leave Bolivia and travel to the high plains of Colorado to check out the wild animal sanctuary firsthand.
Pretty much instantly, we were all the same mind. Pat had read all about the operation, and he knew it, and it was kind of like, well, both of us were. What does it take for this to happen? We would both like to do it.
Upon first sight of the big open expanse of the surrounding area of the Wild Animal Sanctuary, Pat and the ADI leaders meet for the first time as he shows them around the sanctuary grounds. The large habitats and professional care for all animals on site is quickly realized, which inspires Jan and Tim to decide that this may be the final leg of their grand plan.
You know, ADI would never take animals anywhere unless we've even looked at it. So Jan and I came, and you know, it's fantastic.
Just over one of the rolling hills to the north, Pat directs their attention to an empty plot of land. The two groups agree to be partners, sharing construction costs and the care of these animals for life. Bolivian authorities want the lions out of the country, so ADI has the monumental task of organizing the biggest airlift of lions in history, and Pat's team must build them a home. Now, Pat has 6 short weeks to build an enclosure large enough to support 25 African lions. The temperature in Bolivia during this time of year is a balmy 25 to 30 degrees Celsius. Although the winters are mild on the plains of Colorado, winter storms regularly buffet the valley, plummeting temperatures below freezing. To make the transition easy for these cats, Pat and Casey have cooked up a one-of-a-kind plan.
Casey and I are always doodling on the table where we meet in the morning.
I'll draw something, and he's like, no, I don't get it. So he'll redraw it the way he sees it. So we finally meld our two drawings together into something that we both see and understand in our minds of what it is we're going to use.
Once completed, the Lion House will have 8 separate interior enclosures. It will allow the lions to become acclimatized to the Colorado environment. Each space has a gate that leads to 80 acres, which Pat and his team will split into 4 large habitats.
We always want to make sure that we're going to build something that's not going to get anybody injured now or anytime in the future. So this thing is going to be strong enough to hold and withstand pretty much anything.
But the arrival date is rapidly approaching, and Pat and the team have a daunting task before them. The success of this mission hinges on completing this structure. Santa Cruz, Bolivia. Now that ADI has a permanent home for the 25 circus lions, they must get to work planning more raids on remote circuses throughout Bolivia. Jan and Tim and the ADI staff spring into action, trying to get a jump on the circus owners before they get a chance to flee. Word is spreading quickly throughout the country, and time is definitely not on their side.
This circus could make a run for it, and we could lose these animals, so let's just get going as fast as we can.
We've got 2 circuses we have to get to this morning. We have to go to Rabore, then straight to Taperas, where the circus has just agreed last night that they would hand over their animals.
We've just got a message back, and we're pretty confident the police are going to block anything happening. But it's a very unstable situation. We have to get there quickly. We have to get these lions under our control.
Some circuses simply abandon their animals by the side of the road, while others try to flee police pursuit. However, ADI is unwilling to give up the hunt until they remove all of the animals. Finally, seeing the lions firsthand reveals the horrific living conditions circus owners force these animals to endure for their entire lives. These horrifying conditions have crushed these animals in spirit and have done irreparable physical damage. An empty shell is all that remains of these once mighty creatures. Now, as difficult as it is for some of the owners, ADI can begin the process of bringing these cats back from the brink.
I promise we will look after her. We'll look after her, really.
Remarkably, the ADI team has seized several lions in the span of 1 week due to months of planning and constant monitoring. Now the team can bring them to the secluded compound in Santa Cruz, where the lions will recover and regain their health for the journey to Colorado.
Now we're all loaded up. We've given them a drink of water, we've fed them, given them a good check. We're really pleased. They're on their way to a fantastic new life.
These rescues went smoothly. However, there are still several circuses on the run, and the next confiscations will put Jan, Tim, and the ADI team in serious danger. This rescue is vastly different for Pat than normal rescues because he is accustomed to running the rescue from start to finish. But although his involvement is minimal in the rescue, he has his hands full with this gigantic construction project that now monopolizes all of his time.
We've got a matter of just 6 weeks to turn this wide open space into a 200-acre complex for 25 African lions.
With the deadline looming on the horizon, Pat and his crew dig in by beginning to build the road leading to the Lion House. While Pat and Casey continue working on the construction, the ADI team continues to monitor all of the confiscated animals in Bolivia, producing detailed veterinary reports and personality profiles, which they continue to send to Becca and Shiloh.
This is Kiara. You can see how much she enjoys her tire.
They have video diaries that they sent us that kind of go through all the different things about the animals. We don't usually get information like that, so this has been wonderful for us. This puts us way ahead of the game for the animals.
This information allows Becca and Shiloh to begin planning where they will place the Bolivian lions once they arrive at the sanctuary. For Pat and Casey, not even Colorado's winter storms can stop progress. For them to make the deadline, everything must go perfectly, and any delays will be costly. But as Jan and Tim work their way through Bolivia, one circus remains at the top of their list. An operation in San Borja, 1,200 kilometers from Santa Cruz, has 8 lions in their possession. The circus owners have failed to comply with the new ban. They are combative and hell-bent on keeping their lions. For the ADI crew, this confiscation will be one of the most dangerous missions to date.
This is the tensest bit of the seizure.
Okay, guys, let's go.
Arriving on the scene, one of the circus owners confronts Jan and Tim with a knife. He has already slashed the beast wagon's tires, preventing ADI from removing the lions. Behind him, Campion, one of the smaller males, has already collapsed several times in the ring, and now he and his siblings are barely holding on. With their condition worsening, Jan wants to get them out as soon as possible. But these owners try everything to stall the rescue, and if ADI doesn't get the lions out soon, one or all of them could perish.
Right now, tires. Done now. Martin?
Yeah?
Lean on him. He needs to get the tires pumped right now.
After more stalling by the circus owner, the team can no longer wait. They must get these lions out of harm's way now and spring into action to fix the tires. As the situation radically escalates in intensity, time is of the essence, and the crew must work quickly. Finally, the crew departs with the biggest family of lions yet. The deadline is getting closer as the lion ark is getting almost full to capacity. As ADI sees the animals, they must build holding cages in their Santa Cruz compound. This is a MASH unit for lions. The rescue animals receive daily veterinary attention, and the process begins to get them ready for their flight to freedom. Conditions are rudimentary and geared to keeping the animals secure, well-fed, and healthy. There can be no risks taken at an operation like this, so the ADI team must race against time to get them moved quickly. The arrival date also weighs heavily on Pat's shoulders, and suddenly the pressure to hit their own deadline forces the crew into overdrive to work nonstop 7 days a week to ensure every last hammer and nail is complete.
We've been working our tails off here for, you know, 7 weeks straight, 7 days a week, killing ourselves to make sure this is done right, but that's because we want to make sure that it's good for the animals. You know, we've all reached the point where we're exhausted, we're dying, but at the same time, now that the animals are coming in, we'll get re-energized with that whole new animals, getting to meet them, getting to see them, get them in there. You know, so we'll all have to pull some serious hours to make sure that the transition happens, you know, well, and with the animals being the least amount of stress as possible.
With the lion tent's exterior shell fully wrapped over the beam structure, Pat's team can finish constructing the interior habitats and start to build exterior fences to keep a safe buffer between each lion group.
Basically, their pens are the inner fence, but you have to have a secondary fence in case they were to get out of those. And so basically, we have the whole perimeter fence done except for across these two driveways. So we're just temporarily putting this fence across so that at night or when we're not driving back and forth through it, we'll pull this fence up and close it so that it's a complete thing. So we have to make sure that 360 is pretty much completely enclosed around them.
Tensions begin to escalate as the hurried schedule puts everybody to the test.
Yeah, and the other two are
in. You keep saying it goes in the middle.
I said it's in the middle, not goes in the middle.
Now, the once attainable deadline moves forward at a rapid pace, and the stress pushes the crew to the limit.
We got done unrolling it.
You were here, you rolled it out.
She was not there.
Right, so wouldn't it be good to say something to somebody instead of just walking off expecting that?
Don't give me that. It's right outside the door. If you go outside, you will trip over it.
I said, well, go put it in the truck, and that was it.
While the time constraints are immense, both Becca and Shiloh remain vigilant as they study the latest updates on the lions that arrive from the ADI team to better understand the needs of each rescued lion to date.
ADI actually has been really great as far as giving us a lot of background history on each one and their physical characteristics and who's who and where they came from. And so, yeah, we all have a sheet that lists each one and the specific things about that one. So we've all studied and learned the differences of where they came from and what may be a factor for one might not necessarily be a factor for the other. So, yeah, we've taken the last couple of weeks and tried to learn that very well, so we're prepared when they get here.
ADI has just a few more lions to rescue in the far reaches of Southeast Bolivia. One group in particular continues to elude ADI, preventing the repo of Hercules and his family.
So we were ready for this situation that one of these circuses might try and make a move for it.
In order to keep on track to hit the rapidly approaching Operation Lion Arc departure date, Jan and Tim send in an operative to keep tabs on this traveling circus's location. With everything on the line, the ADI team is ready to pounce and seize this group of lions at any moment. Once word was received that this mobile circus group location was static, the sting operation wastes no time to make their move. But these circus owners and their animal trainers do not comply with the ban and will not go down without a fight. They threaten to beat up Jan and Tim, and the resistance to get this family of cats out of harm's way turns into one of the most intense seizure events the ADI team ever faced. Now that the lions were successfully ousted from their captors, the ADI team is worried that the opposition will continue to go on the rampage and follow them on the long road back to the safe zone compound in Santa Cruz. ADI drives the lions along the worst possible roads through mountain passes, where a mistake will send the top-heavy trucks hundreds of feet down into the ravine. Exhausted and anxious, the ADI team drives into the night. In Colorado, Pat and Casey have run into a problem. One of the mechanized doors is improperly installed, and any setbacks could prove to be catastrophic as little precious time remains on the clock.
You know, it's something we do all the time is improvise, and this is something that, you know, we didn't get to see these pulleys before they were sent to us, and they're not the kind that come apart, so there's no time to switch gears. We need to get these cut and go ahead and weld them on. Improvising is the name of the game here because we basically run into this kind of situation day in and day out, especially when you're on the road trying to do a rescue. You never get there and you never know exactly what it is you're going to run up against.
No shortcut can be made, and every safety measure must be taken into account.
Yeah, so right now we're putting together the cables that lift all the gates so that we can test all these. What I would do is grind these off, take this out, put the cable through, and then weld this right to the header.
If they don't build the lion tent passageways safe, the entry into the lion's new home will have huge repercussions. This is a risk Pat is not willing to take.
Hopefully nothing goes wrong and it's all on schedule, but we'll have to see. So it's basically been full blast for about a month now, and I can't wait till they get here and then I can have a day off.
On the heels of the arrival of their nail-biting lion recovery, the ADI crew receives word of one last horrific sight. This time, it's for Kimba, the oldest and most fragile of all the lions whose zookeepers entombed in a small enclosure to rot away the rest of his life. With the short timeline to prep the lions already seized, Jan and Tim jump back into the heat of the action.
We've just arrived at Tarija, and the crate's being unloaded. This is to collect lion number 25, Kimba, who was dropped off at the local zoo by one of the circuses. And today, he starts his journey to freedom.
ADI officials get back to business, stopping at nothing to smash down the concrete walls to tear him away from his life of misery. The bars are cut away, and this rescue is the final capstone to a total of 8 sting operations.
We move really slowly. One. Turn, slow, down. If he starts getting agitated, we can just stop.
But they need to move quickly, and Kimba is instantly flown back to Santa Cruz. For the first time ever, Animal Defenders International has closed down every animal circus in a country and rescued every creature confined. ADI has found homes for all the other animals inside Bolivia, but now their biggest challenge is moving the lions. Back at the holding compound, ADI makes final preparations to put Operation Lionheart into its final stage.
In the next 10 days, we're counting down to the airlift of Operation Lionheart.
The on-site vets conduct final checkups and routine care to make sure all of the lions are nursed back to health and physically ready for the big trip north to Colorado. The crew builds the last remaining transport crates and make sure all of them are properly labeled and color-coded for each of the family groups so every lion can be loaded.
It's quite late, but we're done. Then we're on our way to Denver.
The day of reckoning has finally arrived, and the media bombards the Wild Animal Sanctuary staff with a frenzy of questions as last-minute construction details must still be completed in anticipation of the historic rendezvous at the Denver International Airport.
Okay, thank you. Bye. I'm so sorry. It's a good thing I have 2 years.
Before the dust can settle, Pat and his crew head back to the Lion House to make their final preparations as the ADI team makes their last move to load a waiting charter plane.
Yeah, so we're right in the middle of installing the railing for the building, for the observation deck, but we really wanted to kind of do some sort of tribute to the animals, where they came from. Coming from Bolivia is special, obviously, and so the Bolivian flag is red, yellow, and green, and we thought that might be a nice little touch for the lions. They may or may not appreciate it, but, you know, it just shows our dedication to want to try to, you know, honor where they came from and keep that in mind. You know, so we have the deck up here, which is really important for the lions' sake, so they don't feel like we're crowding them down below whenever we're here. We're kind of proud of the fact that we were able to build this building in about a week. Obviously, all the details, you know, will drag on for many more weeks to keep that stuff in line so that it's done by the time the lions get here.
A flurry of activity puts the final touches on the exterior facade and interior walkways, so the invited public can view the arrival of Operation Lionheart.
All right, puppies.
All right, thanks for bringing the toys.
No problem.
Then Shiloh and the rest of the crew finish cleaning and line up the trailers to help assemble where each lion family will go. ADI and their diverse army of dedicated staff are on target for departure as they set into motion the huge caravan to the Santa Cruz Airport. The loading of each cage onto the private charter jet goes according to plan. It's a big job that takes a cohesive, organized effort. And now the cargo plane is ready for takeoff to make the long transcontinental journey direct to Denver, where all 25 lions will live out the rest of their lives on the open grasslands of Colorado's Front Range.
So, look forward to having 25 new kids here and this afternoon, this evening, and we'll be busy taking care of them all night. But for now, we just need to get rid of, finish this list up and get it done.
Now, with less than 12 hours to go and working nonstop around the clock, a few loose ends still need to be addressed at the Wild Animal Sanctuary to put the nearly impossible deadline to rest.
We gotta get going. We only have a couple hours left before the lions are gonna be here, so we gotta get going on this. So get everybody finishing up what they're doing, all right?
Time is of the essence, and with Operation Lionheart finally airborne, there's no turning back. The ADI team and the 25 rescued circus lions will soon arrive at the Wild Animal Sanctuary as the massive 5,000-mile journey granting these lions a new lease on life is about to become a reality. Coming down to the final minutes of the build, Pat and his team have a few remaining tasks to complete. They still need to hang the signs on the second floor of the Lion House and fill in dirt around the outside of the building. The crew has been working nonstop and nerves are wearing thin. Now that the team has done all they can to finish the Lion House, they can focus on the task at hand, transporting and offloading 25 African lions. As Pat and the crew wrap up final touches on the Lion House, Casey heads to the visitor center to load one of the most important pieces of equipment, the forklift. This is the final preparation the crew will make before they depart for the airport.
It's about 10:30 and we've got still some more details to finish up, so we got another hour, hour and a half to finish those things. Yeah, the jet is a little bit late right now, which is good for us. We're buying a little more time to finish up some details.
With time ticking away, Casey spots a potential problem with the trailer's low tires. It will pull the most important piece of machinery to the airport, the forklift. If anything happens to the trailer during the trip to the airport, the whole mission could be in jeopardy.
Well, those tires are low. One thing like this where you don't check the tires and the tire blows out on the way down there and the forklift wrecks could screw up the whole day. And so all the little details are what you have to pay attention to, because those are the ones that will slip by and then kick you in the ass later.
Now that the forklift is on the trailer, the crew can depart the sanctuary. But one doubt still lingers in Pat's mind. In order to safely load each of the lions, the forklift must have a several thousand kilogram counterweight to balance the heavy cages. This massive load, now perched precariously on a trailer moving at 95 kilometers an hour over rough country roads.
We have it on a 22,000 pound rated trailer and it's squatting it pretty good, so I'm kind of nervous that those tires might not make it all the way down there, and then we'd be in big trouble because everything's relying on that forklift showing up. We've got Casey right behind him so he can keep an eye on the tires, hopefully spot any problem before, you know, we have a blowout or anything like that. So everybody just went through security, and right now we're getting out onto the airfield at DIA and going into the United Hangar. We have way more road to cover that could be, you know, treacherous things, and so yeah, I'm starting to feel the nervousness of this whole thing just to make sure that it all goes well.
Arriving at the hangar, Pat and his team have overcome one major hurdle by avoiding an accident with the trailer. But this is not the only hardship they will face tonight.
All right, man, we're here. It's time to help some lions and go to work.
Now, with all the preparations made, all the sanctuary crew can do is wait. Flying high overhead, Jan and Tim check over the lions, making sure that they all have enough water and are weathering the flight. The journey is nearly complete as the Rockies appear on the distant horizon. In a few short hours, they will see these lions take their first steps on grass and feel the freedom of a large open space. As the wheels of the plane touch down in Colorado, the efforts and sacrifices that Jan and Tim have made over the past several years are about to culminate in a huge success.
It was really exhilarating. It really was a sense of we are here. Every single lion is safe. They're fit and healthy. It was good. So that was a great moment.
Seeing the plane for the first time makes this whole experience suddenly real for the sanctuary crew. The lions have finally come home. Jan, Tim, and the rest of the ADI team exit the plane to the sounds of loud applause.
Casey, nice to meet you.
Lovely to meet you.
Congratulations.
Becca has spent the past few months studying each lion's characteristics, and now the thought of seeing them firsthand is overpowering.
I think it's going to be pretty overwhelming and pretty awe-inspiring to get to see them. Get them to not be in little circus crates and actually get the opportunity to feel grass. These guys have been through a lot, so I feel happy that they're going to be here.
While the crew anxiously waits for their work to begin, Bob Barker, a famous game show host and the donor who made this airlift possible, joins Jan, Tim, longtime ADI supporter and actress Georgia Fox, and Pat to address the crowd.
We're looking forward to getting all 25 lions to where they could live freely and enjoy life as a pride of lions the way that nature intended it. And we look forward to giving these lions a wonderful life. Thank you.
Pat is on a schedule and anxiously waits for this press conference to end so he and his crew can begin loading the lions into the sanctuary's trucks.
Everybody seems to be on the same page at this point. We all know what we're going to be doing. But in any case, it's going to be kind of down to a carefully orchestrated unloading here.
According to their schedule, you know, it's going to take 2 hours. Hopefully it won't take 2 hours, but at that point we'd theoretically be leaving at 6 o'clock. It's obviously going to be getting dark at that point, so we'll have that to contend with.
With so many variables at play, everyone runs through an endless list of scenarios of what could happen. Tension is running thick, and everyone can feel it. All eyes are on Pat and his team now, and under this amount of scrutiny, Pat wants to make sure everything goes smoothly.
Let's go slow and easy with these first ones. We'll start with the family groups and get them in the trailers as they come out the stack.
The crew falls into rhythm as they load the first few lines. Everything seems to be working exactly as they planned. But as Casey maneuvers the forklift into position to delicately place one of the lines into the trailer, there's trouble.
The tire went flat.
This setback brings the whole operation to a grinding halt.
Let's go ahead and get it on the trailer right now. So do you guys happen to have a forklift we can use? Because that tire is boiling out.
But when there's a problem, Pat and Casey always have a solution. Pat reappears behind the wheel of one of the airline's large forklifts, and as the night moves into late evening, the sanctuary crew gets back to business. After a few more slight setbacks, the team puts this chapter of the journey to rest. These lions still have a long road of recovery before them, beginning with their introduction to their new homes.
We got them all loaded, had some snags along the way, but it worked pretty well. I think all the lions were happy, and so we're ready to go. So now it's time to head back to the sanctuary and get them into their new home.
As it approaches midnight, the sanctuary crew's work has just begun. Now, Becca, Shiloh, and ADI's months of careful planning will be put to the test as the sanctuary crew begins to offload the lions.
Most of these animals were together in groups when they were rescued. They had to separate the males from the females so that there wouldn't be any further breeding. However, you gotta remember that there's different families here, so some males are from the same family and have already established who's in charge and all that. Other males came from other families, but yet they're adjacent to each other.
Everyone watches in nervous anticipation as they unload the first lions. No one knows how these cats will react to their new homes.
They're so used to going like 4 steps and then that's it. They have to turn around and go back. And you can see the first time they go in there, they're like going and they're kind of like, I'm expecting to hit a fence, and all of a sudden they aren't. And then it doesn't take but, you know, another few seconds for them to go woohoo and then take off in a full run. I think that none of these guys have probably had a chance to run since they were cubs. This is probably the first time ever.
As the night progresses, everything seems to be going smoothly.
Everybody's having a ball. Yeah, it's just what we thought, you know. They love this environment, this natural environment, this freedom to just run some space, so everything's going great.
Pat and his team move a nervous female into position as the lions begin to work out their new relationships with their neighbors.
It's okay, come on.
When the girls start coming in, the males want to make sure, okay, you know, you're with me, get over here, you know. Don't go over and talk to this male because we don't know him and I'm not about to share him. And so the possession, what we call possession, starts to happen. The males are gonna run over to the girls and make them like hunker down. Hey, you're mine. Don't even begin to talk to this male. And so there's just a lot of tension going on at that point.
Left with no other choice, the female flees to the only safe place she can find.
Whoa.
You're okay, sweetie.
she just wasn't having it. She was like, this is too freaky. I don't even know this space. I don't know what you're doing. So she went ahead and jumped up on the intermediate fence. And that's okay with us. It's acceptable in the sense that it gives her a space to go. We just had to kind of calm down, let her, give her some time, let her make the decision on her own. We still hadn't unloaded her sister, and we knew that that would be the calming factor, was to get her sister out. We put her in the adjacent pen so that she could choose to go there and just calm down. That worked out really well. Eventually, she went back in the pen with the male, but we opened the intermediate gate, she came through. Once that was done, you know, all the tension was off, and so she calmed down real well.
So we got all 25 lions in here. It's now almost 2 o'clock in the morning, so, you know, they're glad to be out of the small crates they've been in for the past 20 some hours, so it makes it worth it.
Before these lions can set foot in their giant open habitats, they will have to undergo some major rehabilitation. But for now, they settle in for the night. As the first rays of light hit the plains of Colorado, the sanctuary team has a lot to do. The first steps towards getting the lions outside are to ensure that they can't breed and to tend to some other serious issues. The ADI veterinary team in Santa Cruz did an excellent job addressing and identifying health issues, but undertaking surgery in the rudimentary field station would have been too dangerous. And now in the safety of the sanctuary, the crew can get to work addressing these problems.
So we have a couple of lions that definitely have some health issues that are going to need to be addressed right away. Unfortunately, these guys coming from circuses didn't have the best care. It's going to be a long day with sedation, implants, checks, blood draws, all that kind of stuff.
In order to do this, Pat has arranged for a veterinary dentist and another vet specializing in larger animals to come in on the same day. But to make it safe enough for them to perform their jobs, Pat and his crew must sedate 16 of the 25 lions. No small task.
At this point right now, what we'll do is get the girl sedated, get our stuff done. Dr. Emily, who's a world-renowned dentist for large carnivores, is coming, and he'll be able to check all the mouths of the animals as well. Since these are all brand new, this is the only time that we're going to be sedating them, hopefully for quite a while. We need to take every opportunity to check everything we can.
As the drugs begin to take effect, the team takes advantage of their limited time. Pat and his crew implant all of the female lions with a microchip and an estrogen implant that prevents the females from breeding. It also prevents males from fighting over females.
Just because we have them sedated, we have the opportunity, we're going to go ahead and draw the blood just to see how healthy they are, if there's any other things that are happening that we can't see physically just yet.
Once the crew finishes their work, the vets take over, and what they find is heartbreaking.
So many of the animals that are in captivity end up having broken canines or other problems with their mouths since they were biting fences and things like that.
As bad as these lions' teeth are, it will take a miracle to repair them. Once the veterinary dentists identify the lions that need dental attention, Becca and Casey prep them for surgery. The dentists go to work fixing each lion's teeth as quickly as possible. One by one, the lions receive the dental care they need, and Casey shuttles them back to their enclosures. The last two large males have the worst teeth out of all of the lions. After extracting several teeth, the job is finally done.
All the dentistry's done, everything else is done, they're all starting to recover, so the team did a great job, and we're thrilled that we were able to do this all in one big fell swoop, and the animals are already starting to wake up, and I think that was a great day.
Several months have passed, and the lions have made steady progress. Pat and his crew have worked tirelessly to bring lions together to form prides. Some groups worked well, while other lions that came from different parts of Bolivia will take more time. Now it's time for the Bolivian lions to live like the rest of the animals on the sanctuary, experiencing life as a pride, roaming their large exterior habitats. As Casey completes each new habitat, the crew releases each group into their new territories. No longer confined to tiny cages, the Bolivian lions can now experience life on the plains of Colorado.
He's looking good.
Yeah, the manes are great.
It really is as close as you can get to that wild experience. And I know we can't give them the world back, but it's pretty damn close.
Finally, after several months of hard work, the sanctuary finishes the final outdoor habitat. With Jan and Tim in attendance, the final lion pride takes their first steps into their wide open territory. For Jan and Tim, their unbelievable journey has come to a close. The blood, sweat, and tears they have shed over the past several years are now worth it, watching these cats take their first steps into their new lives as free-roaming lions.
Those cubs, they were the last animals to ever perform in Bolivia. And it's incredible to see them running free, and they're energizing this whole family.
Oh, get him!
This is the ultimate. This is absolutely amazing. Everything that's been done has been working our way towards this. This is as much freedom as they will ever know. The
last things you want to be. We're thrilled. This building was an amazing project. Meeting all these lions, getting used to them was an amazing project. Getting them out there and really seeing them and, you know, enjoy their freedom was a great thing. We're not done by any means, but it's kind of nice to get these guys to a point where they're really kind of self-sustaining other than us taking care of them on the side.
While the team takes a moment to enjoy this huge success, there are still animals in need. And it won't be long before Pat and his team face obstacles and danger when they head out on their next rescue.